Last week during one of my live broadcasts, I attempted to make a minimalist beach theme poster. And 3 days later, I low-key hated it. I mean, it's not horrible, but it's not exactly great. Being who I am, I wanted to make it great, or at least attempt to make it greater than it was. That's what I'm gonna talk about today. This brand new poster design that I made entirely in Affinity Publisher. Because if you're paying Adobe $50 a month just to make posters in InDesign, well, that's just foolish. Yeah, gauntlet tossed. Again. Now before we get into the new design, let me drag myself through the mud a little bit for this first design that I made. Like I said, it felt great in the beginning, but after I had a chance to look at it for a while, it was like, nah, it's not the worst. I mean, it's a competent design. It's just not gonna win any design awards anytime soon. Not that I'm applying for design awards, but if I was applying for design awards, I would be wasting my money with this one. It's not really exciting. It's just there. That's not what I want from my work. I don't want it to be just there. I wanted to go everywhere. Secondly, it doesn't feel anything like me. This one just feels too safe, which if you know anything about my work, that's definitely not a word you would use to describe it. I mean, my work is definitely not running with scissors dangerous, but it's definitely not safe. My work is more akin to drinking an ice cold glass of water in Tijuana, Mexico. That level of danger. And finally, despite me making a video just last week about diving deeper into high concept design, I did exactly zero effort in that regard, which is what we're gonna fix right now, but only if you hit that like button. Here's the personal design brief on this one. Designed a poster series and other merch highlighting some of my favorite California state beaches. Torrey Pines kinda has a special place in my heart because, well, I've got family nearby. The beach sits between Del Mar, California and La Jolla, California, and it, you know, it's a really beautiful area. In fact, my wife and I have talked about, like, what are we gonna do when we retire? Like, are we gonna stay here? And we often talk about, like, maybe our ending up down in that area just because it's nicer and we'd be closer to family. And although I have this very personal attachment to this beach, I'm not gonna use any of that information to inform my design at all. Instead, let's talk about the things that Torrey Pines is to everyone. Well, first, it's a beach, duh, and it's really great for surfing. Secondly, it's a nature preserve with apparently rattlesnakes, which is something I didn't know before I started this. Third, it's a shore fisherman's paradise. I'm not a fisherman, and I don't even know exactly what they catch on this beach, but my father-in-law is a fisherman, and he says, well, lots of people go there to fish. Fourth, it's actually one point on an entire extension of beaches that extends all the way north to Solana Beach and down to La Jolla, California. The thing about that, though, is that all of those beaches kind of look the same. So there's really nothing unique about the beach area of Torrey Pines Beach. Unless, of course, you happen to catch a rattlesnake that just is sunning his body on that sandy shoreline. Okay, but what exactly do pine trees have to do with this beach park? Good question. I'm glad you asked. This is a Torrey Pine. And Torrey Pines are actually quite interesting because this is the only native pine tree in this coastal region of San Diego County. It's also the most rare pine tree in all of North America. Didn't know that. And it's unique for its uncharacteristic shape with these long, spindly branches that extend more outward than they do upward. To me, these look like the bonsai trees that you find at flea markets that decided they didn't want to be tiny anymore.
Bonsai, choose. Way grow because root strong.
Also, let's talk about the color palette of this photo by amateur photographer Alfred Essa. This tree rests in the middle of the nature preserve and tends to be a very popular subject for photographers. Aside from the typical greens and browns of the tree itself, the reddish gold of the sandstone that the tree grows in is typical of this area as well. You place all that against the brilliant blue sky with the wispy clouds and the untamed tree branches themselves, and it's like a near perfect representation of natural color. So how do we take all this information and parse it down into a better design? Easy. Like this. Click. Thanks very much. I'll see you next time. Remember, be good today, be even better tomorrow. I'll see ya. Just kidding. I wouldn't leave you hanging like that. But let's be clear about something first. How I made this design is far less important than why I made this design. So again, for comparison, old design, new design. First, let's talk about all the things that I feel are a little bit more enigmatic of me. What about this is more me than the other one? Most importantly would be the textures. As you can see, there's quite a few textures going on in the background, and there's textures with the tree itself. It just, like, it has this tension of the tree, you know, kind of coming from off the page. There's a little bit better work with the balance of things. Maybe I'm overstating it a bit. I just feel like there's got a little bit more tension here in a good way rather than this design over here, which is just kind of like, meh. But let's go ahead and tear it all down and go step by step so you can see why I did all the things that I did. To start, I decided to use this kind of cream-colored background, which is a little bit representational of the sandstone that we saw in the picture, and also, you know, the sandy beach aspect too. I originally had it a little bit richer in color, a little bit more yellowish, goldish color. It was just competing too much with all the other elements, so I decided to back it off a little bit. Now, the next thing I did, and I'm gonna zoom in here so you can see, is I kind of added these circles to represent what I thought was fish scale. I don't necessarily want fish to be a major thing. Fishing is a thing, on this beach, but it's not the only thing. I feel like I wanted to say fish without actually saying fish. I don't know if people will actually get that, but this is my intention with the design that you see here. Whether somebody gets it or not is irrelevant. What matters is that it creates a certain amount of texture and depth to the image that has some symbolism that maybe they'll get after they see it, and they'll say, oh, remember? We went fishing there, and that's like fish scales. Now, I also wanted to incorporate something that represented the sea itself, and so I found this texture through Envato Elements. I wanted something that kind of had a wave look to it, a little bit of a whoosh, a little ch-ch-ch. That's what waves look like. Ch-ch-ch. They don't sound like that, but still. You got the background as one color, you got the fish scales as a slightly different color, and then you got this color, and it just kind of creates a little bit more depth within the image. Now let's jump to the photo, and as you can see, I didn't use any of the colors from that photo. The only time I wanted to use those colors was to create this swatch palette right up here. I wanted to pull those colors from the photo and then use them in here. I desaturated the image completely, and then I set it to darker color. At first, I just had it to multiply, but I knew I was gonna be painting over it. And originally, I just painted over top and set that to multiply as well, and it just, for some reason, it just wasn't getting quite the effect that I wanted, so instead, I decided to put it underneath. So when I changed the tree layer to darker color, it just gave this kind of overprinted look that I really liked. I thought it was interesting, and it kind of created an interesting dynamic to that painted layer. And the painted layer had its own issues, which as you can see is kind of some of the backgrounds being shown through. I didn't want that, so what I did is I duplicated the tree layer and then filled it with the same color as the background layer here, so that it kind of created this deeper, richer olive green. But as you can see, it wasn't perfect. This is something I'm gonna have to fix. In fact, let's do that right now. All I'm gonna do is command click that tree-ish green layer there. I'm gonna go back to my background tree layer. Make sure I'm gonna grab the right color here. Then up to edit, I'm making sure I'm on the right layer, and then I'm just gonna hit fill with primary color, deselect so you can see it, and now you can see all those little nuances that I had that were there before, like that, are now gone. Moving on, let's talk about typography. As you can see, I've got the word Torrey Pines written here in future bold, and I've got it justified all the way, meaning everything on every line is gonna push all the way to the edge. And the reason I did that is because I wanted the letters to have the same weight. I didn't want them to be bigger or smaller than each other, but I also wanted them to, you know, reach out to the same distance. And the best way to do that is by using that justify all. Now in the original one, you can see I was using Helvetica, which is obviously quintessential, you know, modernist type font. Future is also very representational of that era as well. Now the reddish orange color that I got in the type right here is actually representational of that sandstone that we saw next to the tree, but I actually decided to go with blue because there is no other blue in this piece. And I thought, well, I haven't talked about the sky. I haven't talked about the ocean color. I figured I needed some blue in here, so I decided to make it blue. Now, I'm not 100% sold on that. I'm gonna go back and forth. I mean, I kinda like the orange, but I kinda like the blue, and I kinda like the orange, and I kinda like the blue. It just had a different feel in both ways, and who knows, maybe I'll use both. Now, something I did carry over from the original design is this little grouping of dots right up here. You can see it right down here in this corner here, and I dig this, and it's something I might use whenever I do more posters along this whole series. If I do more posters in this whole series, when I do more posters in this series, I'm probably gonna carry this idea over. What this represents is the year that the park was founded. 1889, you can count the dots if you want to. I'm not gonna wait for that. I just feel like it adds a little bit of an architectural element into this design that's obviously very organic in nature. And finally, I dropped the park's motto down here, preserve the reserve. It's not the most clever motto in the world, but it works. I also had it on this one, but I never really was satisfied with the way this one worked out, which is probably part of the reason why I didn't really like this design as a whole. And I also changed the typeface completely there as well, because over here I have an italicized serif font, whereas this is obviously a script. Yes, this has a modernist feel to it, but it also kind of feels a little bit like California arts and craft era, which is like turn of the century stuff. You know, Frank L. Wright? Who's the architect guy? Frank Lloyd Wright. You know, the guy that built all the houses and stuff. It feels like that. That was not intentional, but it definitely came out that way a little bit, which I'm okay with. And then we'll move on to the next one, which I'll actually probably build in this exact same file. Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. Why would I do that? Well, it's easy because I can just go over here, right click on this page right here and go duplicate, and then I can just go about it. Is that particularly necessary? No, not really. But if I wanted to maintain certain elements that are already existing here and I didn't want to just like open up a new document, this way I have the previous design available and the new design available. And that way all I have to do is just kind of change some things. I can change Torrey Pines to Balsa Chica or San Alijo or whatever other state beach that I decide that I want to do. I can just change the type right there and not have to adjust anything. I can also make my dots a little differently and I don't have to fix that whole thing. And I just, you know, bring everything else in as I see fit. Now, of course, I don't want to do that too much because then that makes this document incredibly large. That's a problem for another time. And that's not even the number one reason why I think you should use Publisher to design everything that you do. In fact, the reason that I think you should use Publisher to design everything you do is Studio Link, right up there. Assuming if you already have Affinity Publisher, then maybe you already have Affinity Designer and or Affinity Photo, but if you don't, you probably should. And if you do, well then you already know that Studio Link is actually one of the coolest aspects of this app, because all I have to do if I want to start editing in Affinity Designer is I click that little button right there and I'm in Affinity Designer. Or if I want to be in Affinity Photo, I'm already in Affinity Photo. And each one of these are about 95% fully functional. There are certain things that don't necessarily carry over. Like when I go into the photo persona right here, if I go to my brushes, it doesn't have all the brushes that I have loaded in Affinity Photo itself. Let's go over here to Affinity Photo and you can look at my brushes here. I've got bazillions of brushes in here, which I don't have over here, so I could load them up into Affinity Publisher if I wanted to, and then I would be set. The same thing goes for the adjustments, or rather the effects that I might have loaded in, or any kind of styles that I might have placed. Those things are independent between app to app, and so if you have them loaded in one app but not in the other, well, it's not going to show up in Publisher here. That being said, being able to move between these apps without having to like copy and paste or open the document over here and then open it over there and open it back over here and open it back over there, it's just easier to just be able to move back and forth and makes designing things super quick. This is quick. No, this is quick. It's that quick. So to wrap it up, I mean, this is exactly how I should be thinking about all my designs. I should be thinking a little bit more conceptual about my stuff, and maybe you should be doing the same thing. Put a little extra energy up front into the conceptual aspects of things, and then it'll make the design actually come out, hopefully, a little bit easier the first time. But wait, that's not the end of the story. Because no matter how much I think my designs are cool, there's always gonna be people that have no interest in what I'm doing. To some, the conceptual aspects that I put into my work might just seem like mental masturbation to satisfy my own aesthetic needs. I can spend all the energy I want trying to make something cool, but there's always gonna be some Midwestern mom in rural Indiana who would prefer something a little bit more tacky and cliche. No shade on rural Indiana moms, don't hate. In fact, if you stroll through any beachside community in Southern California, you'll see that the boutiques that have the most customers are usually the ones that have the stuff that's the most generic and cliche. People eat that stuff up. That said, there's still gonna be plenty of people who appreciate well thought out design as opposed to the stuff that you might find in like a convenience store impulse purchase. If you wanna know more about my thoughts on high concept work, then you're gonna wanna watch that video right there. If you like this video, you'll like that one too. And if you like this video, make sure you subscribe and hit that bell button because you never wanna miss a thing. Okay guys, I'm out. Remember, be good today, be even better tomorrow. See ya!